குட் மார்னிங் சார். ஷால் ஐ ஸ்டார்ட்ங்க சார்? சார் குட் மார்னிங் சார்.
ஓகே, யூ கேன் ஸ்டார்ட்.
அ வெரி குட் மார்னிங். ஐ ஓ மை சின்சியர் தேங்க்ஸ் அண்ட் வெல்கம் டு எவ்ரிவன் ஃபார் ஜாயினிங் திஸ் வெபினார். அண்ட் பிகாஸ் ஆஃப் அரசு இன்ஜினியரிங் காலேஜ், வி இன்வைட் யூ ஆல் ஃபார் டுடேஸ் வெபினார் ஆன் சிந்தசிஸ் structural explication and spectral characterization of macro and nano crystals. It is the time to invite Dr. R. Vijayaraghavan, associate professor and head department of physics, to deliver a welcome address.
Very good morning to all. I warm welcome to one and all. Thank you to each and every one of you for being with us for today's webinar. It is my honor to welcome our beloved principal, Dr. D. Balamurugan sir. I welcome our vice principal, Dr. Kalamani Shanmugam ma'am. I welcome the dean of academic, Dr. M. Rukmangadan sir. And I welcome our first year coordinator, Dr. M. Kumaresan sir. It is my pleasure to welcome the chief guest of the day, Professor Dr. K. Sendilkannan, director of R&D, vice principal, research scientist, EGS Pillai of Arts and Science College, Nagapattinam. Now I take this opportunity to welcome the head of various department in our college and a staff member of an institution. I am really happy to welcome research scientists and the participants whoever have joined in this webinar. Once again, I welcome to one and all. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your spontaneous address. Thank you, sir, for your spontaneous address. It's my prime duty to welcome our amiable principal, sir, Dr. D. Balamurugan, to deliver the presidential address. Kindly, sir.
Respected resource person of today's webinar, beloved vice principal, dean of academics, HOD of first year, HOD and faculty members of the physics department of our college, and all the participants from various institutions and regions. A very good morning to you all. Today, I am very happy to hear that the Department of Physics is organizing a webinar on synthesis, structural explication, and spectral characterizations of macro and nano crystals by having Professor Dr. K. Sendilkannan, Director of Research and Development, and Vice Principal, Research Scientist of EGS Pillai Arts and Science College in Nagapattinam as the resource person. Once again, on behalf of the management and myself, I wholeheartedly extend our warm welcome to our resource person. Normally, organizing such type of webinar will give exposure to the latest trends and technologies going in that particular field. And also, it gives a platform to the various researchers and academicians to have interaction with eminent personalities in that particular field. In that series, today we are having Dr. Sendilkannan as our eminent person in that macro and nano crystals. So this is a very good opportunity to all the researchers, those who are doing their research work in macro and nano crystals. So if you are having a very good interaction with our resource person, definitely you can gain a lot from his experience and expertise. So my humble request is try to have very good interaction with our resource person and try to gain a lot from his. With this request, I congratulate for the successful conduct of this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable words. Now, I would like to invite Mrs. S. Pathia, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, to introduce our resource person.
Good morning to all. It is my great honor to introduce our resource person of the day, Dr. S. Senthil Kannan sir. Our resource person has completed BSc in Trivika Government College, Tiruvarur, MSc in AVVM Sri Pushpam College, and he got gold medal in MSc degree. He has obtained MPhil in physics from Manonmaniam Sundaranar University, Tirunelveli. He has passed the UGC examination in his first attempt. He has completed his PhD degree with a highly commended recommendations. He has completed MBA, PGDCA, B.Ed, and also he has awarded Doctoral of Letters. It expresses his meritorious excellence. He is having more than 21 years of experience in teaching and 15 years of research. At his credit, he was visited many countries including Oman, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Singapore, Malaysia, Sri Lanka, Vietnam, Taiwan, Indonesia, and Bangkok. He has published more than 350 papers in international and national journals, and he has presented more than 325 papers in various international and national conferences. He has published 20 books and more than 25 book chapters in his academic career. He has guided more than 75 MSc students, 12 MPhil scholars, and guiding research scholars. Also, he is the online trainer cum resource person for conferences, webinars, and FDP for various universities. He has received 7 awards, such as Best Dean of R&D Award, India 2018, Best Vice Principal Award, India 2018, Best Indian Educationalist Award, India 2018, and received Best Academician Award, India 2018, received Global Scientist Award, Malaysia 2018, received Highest Research Papers Publication Award in February 2019, and also received Senior Scientist Award from Ministry of Commerce and Industries from Government of India. Our resource person is really a wonderful personality and a moral educator. Now he is working as a director of R&D, vice principal and research scientist in EGS Pillai Arts and Science College, Nagapattinam. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you to all.
Thank you, ma'am, for your remarkable address. May I request Dr. K. Senthil Kannan, director of R&D, vice principal and research scientist, EGS Pillai Arts and Science College, Nagapattinam, to deliver a keynote address. Kindly, sir.
Yeah, ma'am, sure. Will you share the PPT, ma'am? Yes, sir. Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. Will you share the PPT, ma'am?
Sir, good morning, sir. I hear my voice, sir.
Can you share the PPT, ma'am?
Okay, sir.
PPT share. Ma'am.
Sir? Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Sir, you continue, yes, sir.
No, PPT is to be not shared, ma'am.
Share it, sir. PPT share it, sir.
Ma'am, illa, ma'am. Inge deliver aagala. Inge clean screen la varala parunga. It's not shown in the screen.
Just a minute, sir.
பின் பண்ணி
கொடுத்தாச்சு.
અરે આ મેં ભર્યું તું એક મહિના પહેલા ભર્યું તું આજે હતું અને ઓન્લી ખાલી એક કલાક નું લેક્ચર છે લિંક મોકલું લે તારે કરવું હોય તો એટેન્ડ થવું હોય તો ના હવે લેક્ચર લેક્ચર છે ભાઈ એક એમને તારો અટેન્ડ કરવું હોય તો લે લિંક મોકલું તને
हेलो सर
या मैम
स्क्रीन शेयर ஆயிடுச்சு சார்
हमें ये तो தெரியல मैम
just a minute sir
Hello ma'am, PPT is not visible ma'am. Participants also they are putting the message. PPT is not visible.
Sir, ippa theriyuda sir?
Inna illa sir, PPT is not visible.
Sir, actually unga slide la vandu PPT theriyuda sir ippa? Oru corner la mattum theriyuda sir?
Illa edhuvume theriyala sir. Participants oda name and avangaloda photos adu mattum dhaan theriyudhu. Display of the participants mattum dhaan theriyudhu.
Appadina sir, oru nimisham irunga sir.
No problem sir, no problem.
அது ஒண்ணும் கிடையாது ஹலோ ஹலோ சார் ஹலோ 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 சார் ஹலோ சார் இது நம்ம கிட்ட அட்ஜஸ்ட் பண்ணி இருக்கோம் இதுதான் சார் இது ரெண்டுத்திலுமே ஷேரிங்ல இருக்கு
ஹலோ சார்
எஸ் சார்
சார் இப்ப பிபிடி ஓகேவா சார்
ஆ எஸ் சார் ஓகே சார்
ஆ தேங்க் யூ
எஸ் சார்
எஸ் சார்
எஸ் சார் எஸ் Yeah, now it's shared. Very good morning to one and all. I would like to invite all for this webinar on synthesis, spectral explication, and spectral characterization of macro and nano crystals at Arasu Engineering College, Department of Physics, Kumbakonam. Before the start, I would like to thank my guide, Dr. S. Gunasekaran sir, a former faculty at Pachepas College and former registrar Periyar University, Salem, and. Also would like to thank our secretary sir Dr. Parameswaran sir secretary EGS Play Group of Institutions and trust member Shankar sir and other faculties including our principal and the host institution the principal vice principal dean of academics also Dr. Vijayaraghavan sir head of the department the coordinators Satya and Shanti Sheila ma'am Also, the faculties of physics and other faculties from other institutions. Now, before getting entered into the particular topic of synthesis, structural explication, and spectral characterization, just we'd like to know what is the synthesis part, what is the structural representation, and what is the spectral applications like that. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah. Actually, our institution is said to be UGC2E of previous slide, sir. Previous slide, yeah. It is a UGC2E of 12B recognized. We got NAG accredited with the A grade, and it is an autonomous institution. And next slide, please. Yeah, crystal system. So those who are said to be at the beginning stage, they can get through the information regarding this. Others, they might know the seven types and all. The faculties might know very well. Previous slide, crystal system, previous one. Yeah, there are generally seven types of crystal system. So they are cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, monoclinic, triclinic, trigonal or rhombohedral, and hexagonal. These crystal system, they have major impact on the application in the electronic field, mechanical sectors, biological application. And some other industrial purpose, including band gap applications that recently we have confined with that. So these crystal system, generally, if you are growing any crystal, they belong to this type of seven crystal system, as I told, and they have the subcategory of some 14 types of lattices like that. Next slide, please. Slide number 5. Yes. Generally, crystal materials are classified as macro, micro, and nano scale. Macro is the bulk, micro is the miniature, and nano scale, macro is said to be further milled to the scale. The milling may take around one day, more than one day. They may take around 48 hours like that, continuous milling. So to get that nano scaling of the macro or micro scales. Like that. Next slide, please. Yeah. Now these are the category of the crystalline materials. Before that, it is size of the crystal. Based on that, we have classified it as macro, micro, and nano. Now, based on the chemical composition and the structural representation, we are calling it as organic, inorganic, and semi-organic. Organic, it is with strong NLO representation. With pi to pi star transition like that. So next further slides we are going to see that organic crystals types. Inorganic, you know, they are said to be having some impact on special applications, but they do not have any carbon representation in their structural characterizations or structural morphology like that. Semi-organic, it is stoichiometrically bonded in the organic material. Any one atom, say for example lithium, like that. So it is stoichiometrically bonded, and it is said to be a single atom present over there. So they are the classification organic and inorganic. In between them, so they are called as semi-organic case. So these three types of crystal systems are generally we are considering organic, inorganic, and semi-organic. They may vary in their optical properties,
and semi-organic, they will have some boosted application in special categories like that, that we are going to define in the further slides. Next slide, please. Yeah, NLO. Generally, crystals, what we are considering, what we have studied is said to be NLO crystals. There are non-NLO crystals also there. These NLO crystals, they are having high impact on optoelectronic properties. So light and electronic application, that nothing but optoelectronic applications. These NLO crystals, they are having the major impact over the optoelectronic properties. They are classified as NLO, non-linear optical crystals. They are generally two types mainly what we are studying according to the research side or according to the student point of view, research scholars like that. Second harmonic generation and third harmonic generation we are studying. Second harmonic generation, directly we can see the light impact over the naked eye through our human eye. Third harmonic generation, say they are having triple the amount of frequency, so we cannot see through our eye, but we are having that impact of the scanning method. So Z scan, we are getting that impact. Next slide, please. Yeah, Schwinger limit. It's a limit in which the electromagnetic field is expected to be non-linear. So non-linear representation, what we are observing is either the wavelength is said to be half of that value, or the frequency is said to be multiplied like that. Multi-frequency effect will be there. So it is called Schwinger limit. From that we are identifying the non-linear representation of our material and scaling for that particular materials, what is said to be grown like that. Next slide, please. Yeah, structural elucidation. We have representation. We have some title representation for this particular structure. What we are identifying from the structure is when we are growing the crystal, we are identifying the structure. It belongs to any one of the seven types of crystal system already we have mentioned, like monoclinic or trigonal, rhombohedral, like that. That is said to be mainly analyzed using the SXRD and PXRD. SXRD, it represents the lattice parameters including the R factor. So from which we can identify the structural elucidation, how much pure the structure is without error like that. Because we are using some programs to identify the structure. From the structure, if it is said to be a single compound, then we are having direct output structure value. If we are having plus and minus, the crystal is said to be represented as A plus and B minus. Say for example, NaCl, Na plus and Cl minus like that, then it is said to be called as Zwitter category. Zwitter ionic representation. The Zwitter ionic representation, they will have more impact for structural solving like the computational and software applications. The powder XRD pattern, it is also one of the tools to identify the elucidation by means of indexing, properly indexing this. So we have the HKL parameter. From HKL, we can calculate the lattice constant using the formula. So from which we are identifying the lattice constant through the indexing, proper indexing and fine tuning effect will give the proper structural identification of the particular crystal. So these are the main tools related to single XRD and powder XRD for structural elucidation. These are the main diffraction patterns. Next slide, please. Yeah. What are the main spectral methods we are using? Generally, single XRD, powder XRD to identify the structure we are using. The elemental composition is by either CHNS or by mass spectrum or any other spectrum, we are using that. And for identification by means of this morphology is through SEM or TEM like that, surface morphology effect like that. But spectral applications generally, as one of the tools it is said to be given, UV visible spectroscopy, FTIR spectroscopy, FT-Raman spectroscopy, mass spectrum and fluorescence spectrum. UV visible, it represents the transmittance or absorbance as well as the electronic transition taking place. Though we are calling it as a spectral approach, where it merely represents the electronics change over there, electronic transition taken place over there. That only it is said to be represented. The transmittance or the absorbance. FTIR is said to be Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy. So FTIR spectroscopy, it is nothing but the change in the dipole moment is said to be analyzed using this. From the change in dipole moment, we are identifying the functional groups. The chemistry people, they might know the functional groups present in the specimen compared to the other science subject. The functional group present in this particular crystal or material can be analyzed through the FTIR spectrum, and they may be properly identified with the wave number in centimeter inverse. Next, FT Raman. So FT Raman is, it is a spectral approach for polarizability, change in the polarizability. So this change in the polarizability will have the effect over there with the FT Raman. So Raman spectrum active or not active with our specimen can be identified. We have one principle called as mutual exclusion principle. From that we can identify which are the peaks that will be more impact or more highlighted, less highlighted, or more intense, less intense, like that we can identify with the FTIR and FT Raman. So they are said to be the pair spectrum. They are called as FTIR and FT Raman. They are called as. Next, mass spectroscopy. Mass spectroscopy, when we are sending the samples for this study, they will give the peaks with the chemical shifts. Based on the chemical shift, we are identifying what is the M by Z value. From the M by Z value, which is the most highly represented over there, the abundance is said to be identified, from which the mass of the particular compound or the crystalline molecule can be identified, and it is said to be confirmed with the theoretical data. It said to be counter verified by the theoretical data. That is mass spectroscopy method. It's the fluorescence. Fluorescence is the electronic transition already we are having. So change in the wavelength taken place to identify the flaws, to identify the spectrum for which the emission is taken over the excitation value, like that, simply called as change in the wavelength value. That is called the representation of fluorescence. So many types of fluorescence are there. Generally, we are having luminescence representation, and one of the type of luminescence representation as fluorescence. This fluorescence is said to be taken place. That only we have studied. So many types like thermoluminescence, phosphorescence, electroluminescence, like that we are having different category for our specimen, which is said to be suitable, that we have to identify and we have to proceed in that manner. It depends upon the sample stability, like that we have to identify, then we can proceed for the further type of fluorescence. Next slide, please. A fluorescence is one of the types of luminescence, and it is a result of absorption of photons, and it's to be applied for these atoms or molecules, like that, compared to the luminescence. Next slide, please. Yeah, now we are entering into the growth methods. Crystalline solids, growth or preparation methods. We are having salt gel method, Zugrowski method, Bridgman method, air itself, vertical and horizontal Bridgman, and solution growth method, slow evaporation, like that. So generally, cost effective method is solution growth method, simply mixing of the two solutions, and we are waiting for some 1 week to some 4 week, that is 1 month, definitely we'll get the crystal. But it is said to be properly grown or properly having this combination of what we have given as the reactants is said to be identified with the diffraction pattern. From the diffraction pattern only we can confirm the crystalline representation or crystal structure identification, like that. Because already we know lattice plus basis gives the crystal structure, so there should be lattice and basis should be properly, they are said to be coordinated, then we will get the proper crystal structure. Otherwise we will not get the all the reactants to get through the identification as the product. Some of them will be left out and they will not have the full crystal structure, like that. They may have deficit or some variation in the crystal structure that could be identified with the diffraction pattern. Next slide, please. This is especially for the PG and the scholars.
PG students and scholars, because they have to know what is to be there. They do not have the practical exposure there. The faculties might know that. We are having the first beaker represent the solution in which the mixture of all the input reactants have to be there with the either generally water is considered or acetone or ethanol or methanol is said to be considered. In rare cases, the solution is said to be changed. So they are allowed to mix over there with the magnetic stirrer, and some heating element is said to be present over there to remove the agglomeration and all. So you'll have the clear solution, and clear solution is with the proper holes over there, and we kept it for evaporating around 15 days. Generally, all the crystals will have maximum of 25 days. It will be grown like that. So time in days after that, we'll have the precipitate of crystals using the solution growth method. And we have to clean using the cloth or some butter paper like that to remove the dust over there. The dust will have the impact in the result. So we have to clean that. After cleaning, we'll get a piece of crystal that will be sent for study of diffraction to get the parameters and identification of the structure, whether it is to be already resolved or the new one. If it is new one, we have to go for structural solvation of the particular crystal using selection program. If it is to be already solved and they do not have any impact of studies and all, then we can confirm that it is already said to be solved. We are having the same parameters. We identify the crystal system. We can proceed for some other characterizations like that. So compared to nano and crystal is said to be only one slight difference. Nanomaterials and crystals, I am telling, not nanocrystals. So there we are having this powder XRD indexing pattern. Then we can proceed for some other categorization. Here we are identifying the parameters. From the parameters, we are going for the next identification of any type of special application like optoelectronic applications or biological amplifications or band gap applications like that. So these are the general representation over the solution growth method to get the diffraction pattern for the synthesis crystal. Next slide, please. A shell-like-shell program. Generally, some of them, they are having own this particular software to get that result. And in IITs and other institutions, some big university, state university, they are having this to refine our crystal. If you are having the proper crystal and we are sending for that, they will structurally resolve this for organic, inorganic, and organometallic. So semi-organic, we told, and some of them, they are organometallic like that. Organic with a metal, and it is stoichiometrically bonded, and it is a special atom, single atom over there, that's called that metal atom. So they are called as a metal organic. So the refinement can be taken place using this, and the refinement of macromolecule against high resolution data can be analyzed using this program. This is one of the structural elucidation using software. Next slide, please. Yeah, first crystal what we have grown and what we have published, that I am going to discuss. Next slide, please. Yeah, this particular crystal DPPA, simply called as aniline crystal. So this published in elsewhere, this elsewhere journal, and it is a dimethyl phenyl prop 2-in-1-ilidine aniline. Generally, we can call it as aniline crystals or DPPA crystal, like that we can represent. So this is the structure of this particular.
Excuse me, sir. Anbu sir and Ramesh Reddy sir, could you please mute your video and audio, sir? It is disturbance of us. Ramesh Reddy sir, could you please mute your video, sir? Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
It's simply called as DPPA crystal. So this is the structural elucidation. We have solved this. So we have the reactants, and we are getting the DPPA finally. So we are maintaining the temperature around 75 to 80 degree, and C2H5OH, you know, it is said to be ethanol. So ethanol as the transmitting medium in the center in the reaction pore, and we have the reactant and we are getting the product. This is said to be the reaction mechanism, simply called as reaction methodology. When it is solved using a structure like with bonds, hydrogen, carbon, like that, then it is a structural elucidation. They're calling it as a structure solved crystal like that. So if it is new, then we can proceed for the new representation for structure solution. If it is already completed, then we can proceed that already the structure is solved. We can go for the methodology of continuation for the particular applications like that. Here it is having optoelectronic applications, and we are trying for biological implication for the crystal also. Since aniline is present, we have one illidine as well as phenyl prop. If it is said to be present, then it could be applicable for anti-inflammatory and antioxidant property like that. So these studies are said to be, it's not yet studied, it's said to be yet to study. We are going for this, the process is said to be going on. Next slide, please. Yeah, generally, when you are going for elsewhere like publications, they need the crystal photograph of the crystal, the size, the implication of length, breadth and height. So three-dimensional representation and the quality of the crystal, how we have grown. If it is said to be already grown, same crystal we are growing, what is the transmitter range? It's said to be opaque or 100% transmittance, and how clarity the crystal is, how the crystal size is like that. And some of the institution, they are giving a best effect for good quality bulk crystal growth like that. Next slide, please. Yeah, XRD. So single XRD using the lambda of 0.711069 molybdenum K alpha radiations at room temperature, the least square method to structurally solve the DPPA crystal is to be taken. Next slide, please. Generally, we are using copper or molybdenum. So those who are working in the diffraction, they might know very well, because we are sending the sample for some of the places they are having copper, and some other places they are using molybdenum like that. So they will have the more impact for the diffraction like that. So the crystal, particular DPPA crystal, belongs to the orthorhombic crystal with a non-centrosymmetric space group of P212121, which identify the fundamental criteria for NLO property. It's a non-centrosymmetric crystal is said to be identified. So it is said to be an NLO crystal from which we are having this representation of, it's a second order or third order crystal. So an NLO application is there. We are identifying the ABC in Armstrong as 7.34, 324 and 13.368 and 14.609. And we know the orthorhombic system is alpha, beta, gamma, all are equal. For monoclinic system, the alpha, gamma is equal, beta is said to be deferred. Beta is said to be varied in angle like that. So this orthorhombic and monoclinic will be the majority of the crystal, because cubic is the basic crystal. Cubic tetragonal is said to be a rare crystal. Orthorhombic, monoclinic, trigonal, triclinic, and hexagonal like that. Hexagonal is very difficult, as you know the structure. They are having the six representation over there. So major criteria of the crystals are mainly three types. Triclinic, orthorhombic, monoclinic will be the usual representation. And some of the other crystals also, it can be grown, and it's said to be a rarest case like that. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is FTR spectrum. So we have the 500 to 4000, that is 400 to 4000 we are using. So we are getting the data. So it's said to be in centimeter increments with the transmittance effect is there. FTR, I already told, it is said to be the Fourier transform infrared spectrum. Infrared we are using for some other lamps, and we are using the TV remotes and all. So we are identifying the change in dipole moment of the particular crystal variation identification, and also we are having some numbers. From the numbers, we are identifying the functional group present in the particular crystal. Suppose I am telling it is an aniline crystal, aniline having some impact of some wave number in centimeter inverse, it's already reported. So if I am calling this particular crystal as an aniline crystal, then the same effect will be identified with the same wave number, more or less some one or two variation is said to be allowed like that. So we have to identify the same wave number is said to be present, then we can confine that this crystal is one of the types of aniline crystal based on this FTAR spectrum like that. Next slide, please. So I'm giving the data. Generally, benzene and aniline is said to be around 1600 centimeter inverts. I fancy that is single bond C, double bond N like that. So same is said to be identified with the 1604 in our spectrum. So this is the proof that we have grown the represented aniline crystal like that. Next, we are having the condensation of aldehyde and amine. Condensation is said to be simply removing like that. So aldehyde and amine is said to be moved, so it is not said to be present over there in the specimen. That is also confirmed. Serious stretching is said to be observed at 2978. A weak bond around this region of 2.5 dppa is said to be observed. The absence of this band of 2720 to 2820 is said to be identifying that there is no aldehyde group in this particular specimen. So this, which implies that aldehyde and amine are said to be condensed and we are getting the pure aniline crystal like that, benzylidine aniline like that. Next slide, please. This is UV transmission. So we have the wavelength from 300 to 1050. You can identify this around 400, 300, it's 450, and near that it's 400 nanometer. That is the value of the wavelength. Next slide, please. Sir, next slide. Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello, next slide, please.
Next slide. Is it okay, sir?
No, ma'am. 23rd slide.
Oh, okay. So share it, sir. 23rd slide.
Change, sir. Ma'am.
Sir?
You have changed, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Changed, sir. It is 23rd slide, sir.
No, it's not shown here. I think it's hanged.
Oh, okay.
One second, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Ramesh Reddy, sir. Ramesh Reddy, sir. Sir, could you please mute your video, sir? Ramesh Reddy, sir. Could you please mute your video, sir?
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, sir. It's hear me. Yes, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Right. I just restarted. It's going to be hanged. Okay. This is the UV continuation. Previously, we discussed this transmittance. Here, it is going to be absorbance with wavelength. Because some of the other calculations, we need absorbance unit in arbitrary units, and some of them, other cases like NLO, we need transmittance value. So we are showing for this crystal the transmittance as well as the absorbance for this UV spectroscopic effect of the DPPA. We are identifying the around 400 plus the value of cutoff. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a tau plot. So it is alpha h nu the whole square with the h nu effect is to be identified. The band gap is around 4.32 electron volt for this particular DPPA crystal. So here we are confining this is best suited for some photonic applications based on the h nu value with the alpha h nu power 2. We have some allowed and not allowed, that is forbidden states like that. So we are having allowed band gap or forbidden band gap like that. When n is said to be the value of that is 1 by n is equal to 1 by 2. So n is equal to half like that. We are having this particular case. So we are having different category from which we are identifying the tau plot. And we have already mentioned the transmittance as well as absorbance. So we are identifying the photonic application of the crystal with band gap. Next slide, please. Yeah, the absorption drastically reduced root the wavelength of around 400, I told. So it is 390 nanometer. For the increase in nonlinear optical property of the materials, the cutoff wavelength is found to be around 500. The crystal exhibit excellent transmittance of 81% around 500 to 1100 nanometer. The band gap from the tau plot is 4.32 electron volt. It's said to be calculated. Next slide, please. Yeah, it is TGA DTA, thermal analysis of the crystal, thermogravimetric analysis and differential thermal analysis of the crystal. That's said to be with the TGA DTA graphs. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a TGA operator. We are identifying it is 98.86 for this, 2.3250 milligram as the initial one, and said to be changed to 2.299 milligram. So what we have observed is it's a thermogravimetric analysis of the temperature versus weight. So weight said to be changed from the proportional of energy change we are observing using this graph. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is 2.3250 milligram, for which 110.77 degree of 108 joule per gram, for 251 for the next point, and 87.56 joule per gram is set to be identified, same temperature with the heat flow. So the TGA as well as DTA is there. This is exothermic plot. So what is exothermic plot? When the reactants are there, output heat is set to be liberated. Output heat is liberated means extra heat is said to be not present. So the material is highly stable. So the stability of the material can be identified using TGA and DTA. Here it is said to be one of the examples for the exothermic plots. So this is there. Next slide, please. Yeah, the same is said to be there. Initial mass is 2.3250 and it's said to be under the temperature range of 35 to 450 degree. The TGA thermogram shows that it is 268.75, it's said to be highly stable, and there is no phase transition up to 268.75, it's said to be mentioned. Next slide, please. The TGA shows it is 114 degree, indicating that material did not exhibit weight loss, around 100 degree, and it is a moisture free one, and the material is having the melting point attribution of 114 degree. The DTA also reveals the same changes in the particular spectral diagram. The TGA curve is understood that the material exhibits a single stage decomposition. Some of the materials having more complicated inputs and they have multi-stage decomposition. Here it is said to be only single stage, only one stage, and it is said to be around 269.67 degrees, right, like that. So that mass is said to be mainly considered, and the temperature in which it is said to be provoking or losing something, and we are having the final effect that is said to be understand and identified using TGA and TTA. Next slide, please. So it is exothermic brick, already I told, and it is said to be the stability of the same could be identified. If it is said to be endothermic, so it is supplied. So it is supplied means the stability will be not that much like exothermic. So it is not highly stable if it is said to be endothermic, but this particular crystal is said to be exothermic. Next slide, please. Now, micro hardness. Next slide. Yeah, HV versus load. Load versus HV is said to be identified for 25 gram, 50 gram, and 100 gram, like that. So we are identifying this material how said to be hard, like that. So it is said to be micro hardness representation. Next slide. So that could be confined with log D versus log P. So we are having the linear fit value of 5.96. Next slide. So from which we are identifying that the crystal is said to be a hard crystal category. According to Onitz, n is greater than 2, we are identifying this. The reverse intonation pattern also can be identified. So we have intonation pattern and reverse intonation pattern. It varies material to material accordingly. Either it should be crystals or any other solids. The mechanical people, they might know very well. So from which we can identify the same. Next slide, please. Next slide. So now the dielectric property of the material can be analyzed. See here, the x-axis is temperature, y-axis is said to be dielectric constant. We are having different variations of frequency. Actually, they have mentioned it as percentage frequency because we are having some representation over there as percentage. But actually, it is a value of the frequency. It's a perfectness we are representing through the percentage. See, the black color gives the 100 hertz and other colors respectively for 1 kilo, 10 kilo, and 100 and 1 megahertz like that. See, from this, we can easily identify when the temperature increases, dielectric value is said to be also getting increased. But when the frequency is said to be increased, the dielectric value is said to be decreased. That we can counter verify. So this is one of the representation of this particular crystal for the electronic applications. Next slide, please. Here, dielectric loss is said to be considered. So because we are concerned, we are confined with either TGDT or any temperature range like that. So previously, what will have that when we are having valves, we don't have that much heat. They will have some lightning effect or some extraneous sound effect like that. Now we are set to be updated with the technology. We are having the ICs and wafers. When IC is set to be there, when heat is generated, then there is a short circuit or circuit is set to be changed or circuit is set to be wrong connected like that. So any material will have that excessive temperature will lead to the change in the temperature should be sent out for some other purpose or energy conversion like that due to the energy criteria, or it should be used for some other representation like say variation of this temperature to the next level. It's practically not possible. So from which we are identifying this dielectric loss also, tan delta we are identifying. Next slide, please. Yeah, AC conductivity, that is said to be mentioned over there with temperature as well as sigma AC. As conductivity is there, it is mo per centimeter, it's said to be considered. Next slide, please. Here it is said to be activation energy. The molecules already there, we are giving some less energy to activate the sum. So the activation energy is nothing but we are giving some energy to activate. That could be identified using log F and EAC like that, from which how the variation graph is to be identified, and EAC can be calculated like that. Next slide, please. Yeah, it is a NLO crystal of 1.25 times that of the potassium dihydrogen phosphate crystal. And we are having this 10 millivolt for 2.5 dppa, for the 8 millivolt for kdp like that. So the variation is said to be observed over there. If it is said to be 8 millivolt, we are having similar value of kdp. It's more than that, so it is 1.25, and it is also second harmonic generation crystal. The variation of the effect of crystal is identified with the green emission light, green emission of light. Next slide, please. The second crystal we are grown, and it's said to be published over there in Electronics, Journal of Electronics. So it is a D32 DMPC crystal. You can simply call it as carboxylate crystal. Full name is diethyl 3,3'2,4 dichlorophenyl methylidine bis 1H indole 2 carboxylate crystal. So here I have mentioned one important point. Organic materials is having delocalized electrons of pi to pi star orbitals. So organic crystal will have this pi to pi star transition compared to the sigma, that change in value, sigma orbital change values. Bonding, pi to pi orbital bonding, it refers to that fluorescence, we have taken the fluorescence. So fluorescence will have the more impact over this bonding
because it is an emission during the excitation process. So these orbitals will have the predominant role over there to identify the fluorescence, because it is a light from cold emission body. So we are having this impact of pi orbitals. So whenever you are having identifying that it is a pi orbital, we are representing the organic crystal like that, we can understand the situation. Next slide, please. Yeah, synthesis. Previous crystal DPPA, just I have given what is said to be there by the reaction mechanism, by structure, by an equation structure like that. Here, theoretically, we are given viable available of dichlorobenzaldehyde is said to be dissolved with ethyl indole 2-carboxylate at a particular temperature. Concentrated HCl is said to be used because some precipitate is there, some other agglomerations are there, some tiny precipitate or said to be not mixed particles are there. So we are using concentrated HCl, properly rinsed over there around 1 hour to completely getting the clear solution. We are using that white product is said to be obtained. It's said to be filtered off with a paper and a cloth and washed with the ethanol to get the purest crystal. Then we can get it analyzed for a diffraction pattern and X-ray pattern. From this, we are identifying the said to be 92.5 yield by slow evaporation of an ethanol solution. So the yield also we are calculating using this. Next slide, please. These are the data from the single XRD. It's said to be monoclinic. I already mentioned beta is said to be varied. So beta is 101 degree compared to the other bonds. So the empirical formula is said to be, it is said to be a hard molecule crystal because it's having more molecules and it will have more impact over there. Next slide, please. Here also the FTIR for this particular crystal is mentioned, the wave number as well as transmittance. We are having mainly 7 wave numbers: 705, 1237, 1618, 2998, 3315, 3421, like that. Because we are having carboxylate, generally acids are called as carboxylic acid. So that represents will have normal impact of the crystal in the FTIR range that we can confine with the functional groups present. Next slide, please. This represents the elemental calculation of the particular crystal, what is the percentage present, and it's said to be confirmed with the software. We are having this JavaScript or C++ coding is said to be identified, from which we are having this elemental case of CHNSO like that, and it had to be counter verified with the theoretical data. Theoretical data is said to be software, so we got all the percentage. And the experimental, we are having CHNSO only, so chlorine is said to be not identified using the system, so it is said to be not detected. Remaining only mentioned over there with the CHNS. So from which we are identifying what the crystal is said to be grown. It's said to be identified for the functional groups using FTIR. It's counter verified by this experimental method of CHNSO and theoretical method for the elements present. Because the crystal we have grown, we have to confirm the crystal, the same crystal what we told as the title, is said to be grown or not. So we have to counter verify the same using this method. Next slide, please. The important point of this particular D32 DMBC crystal is at the beam displacement. How the beam is said to be displaced for long wave and short wave, what is the plate thickness, and how it can be used for filter application like that. So we are calling it as influx measurement. So filter utility is said to be identified. So it is one of the important tools for the measurement of the electronic property. That's what it's said to be. The crystal is said to be, that's why the crystal is said to be published in the electronics journal, Journal of Materials. So material applications in electronic field. Next slide, please. Mass spectrum. See, the crystal, we are having this formula, some CH like that. Each one is having this molecular weight. When you are individually calculate this molecular weight, like carbon 12, oxygen 16, nitrogen 14, hydrogen 1.008, or simply 1 like that, will have the final value of 532.16. Sometimes it is 536, 534.24 like that we are getting by experimental and theoretical we are using. Because theoretical what we can go for anything, and experimental they will have the regular slot of the particular perfect value of the masses.
but from mass spectrum we are having 534. So nearly all are said to be 534.16, 534.24 and 534. So more or less we are getting the same, and this is said to be confirmed from the mass spectrum for the particular crystal of diethyl 313 carboxylate. So D32 DMBC is confirmed with the mass spectrum. Next slide, please. Yeah, as I already told, UV absorbance is to be analyzed. So around around 350, that is said to be the cutoff range from which we are having this impact of optical transmission can be identified, and the application of the crystal can be identified using this transition element present in the UV spectra. Next slide, please. Yeah, weight percent and temperature with the microvolts. Previously, we have two graphs, TGA, DTA, we have mentioned. Here, TGA, DTA is said to be combinedly given for 145 and 186, from which we can identify whether it is said to be the proper consideration of the stability of the molecule using this, because we are having the volt versus temperature and the mass versus temperature, weight percent. We can identify the same using this. So for the D32 DMBC crystal, TGA, DTA graph is provided to identify. It is said to be 196 the range, and 145 from the TGA and 148 from DTA can be confirmed. Next slide, please. Yeah, we are entering into the third crystal. Next slide, please. This is published in a electronics journal, and this is a CPDM HPB HD. That is simply we can call it as benzopyran crystal. So they are having anti-diabetic as well as anti-cancer applications, this benzopyran. So we have grown the crystal such that it could be used for electronic applications, some tribological applications, and some biological applications. Since it's said to be having electronic applications, we can call it as optoelectronic application crystal, NLO crystal, like that. And tribological, it's a roughness nature of the crystal can be identified. It's a mechanical tool, mechanical engineering tool. And we are having this biological application for this crystal. That is said to be not mentioned here because we are dealing with the spectral applications. It's a best tool for biological application, these crystals. Next slide, please. So this is the structure of the input, and we are getting this final CPD crystal. So we have eliminated the methyl group and the CH group and some oxygen and all. So it's said to be eliminated in this reaction automatically. So we are having the fine structure of the final output of the CPD crystal. So this is the reaction reactant as well as product for this particular crystal diagram. Next slide, please. These are parameters. It's also belongs to monoclinic crystal with the group of P2 1 by N. So here the beta is said to be 93 degree, alpha beta ABC is said to be varied, and alpha gamma is said to be same. Filter influx is said to be identified, so it's one of the tools for the filter applications. Influx is said to be 3.11 micrometer. Next slide, please. So it's a nano and macro is said to be confirmed for this particular crystal. Since the paper is said to be immediately published because of this macro and nano scale, macro crystal we have, nano scale it is said to be converted by milling method. We have analyzed for macro and nano both, and slight variation in these values are obtained for dielectric constant epsilon r and tan delta dielectric loss, from which we can compare the macro and nano scale. Final output is said to be presented there. So this represents the dielectric constant and dielectric loss for the log frequency. Next slide, please. Now, dielectric constant for macro and nano crystal with change in temperature. So we can represent this particular graph using, and the temperature is using the figure A and B. When the temperature is said to be varied slightly, there will be an increase in the dielectric constant. Same for the both cases. When the frequency is said to be increased, there will be a value of decrease in the dielectric constant. We can confine that. So next slide, please.
this for the dielectric loss. So there is a small variation in the 100 hertz. It's a low frequency, there will be a more impact of the loss. For high frequency, we are having small variation is to be observed in the loss. That is a general principle because we are taking it as logarithmic value of that. We are not directly taken the 100 value and 1 lakh value like that. It's taken in the logarithmic case. So variation will be more impact for the lower values and not in the higher range. Next slide, please. The important point, photocurrent as well as dark current. So it is a negative photoconductive valued crystals, the CPD crystal. Here applied voltage is photocurrent in nanoampere and dark current in nanoampere is case is observed. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is also there. Wavelength versus intensity and wavelength versus intensity for macro and nano cases obtained. Some 27 nanometer variation is observed for the macro and nano scale, from which we can identify there is a change in the property of refranging. Refranging is change in the wavelength. So that could be identified using this. Next slide, please. This is one of the property of tribological tool for the CPD crystal is identified, that I will discuss in the next slides, coming slides. Next slide, please. Yeah, for CPD crystal, the nano influx is 3.1145. That is an important tool for 16 nanometer size. It's identifying the mechanoelasticity of the crystal in the electronic sectors, as well as mechanoelastic applications in the lifetime of coils can be identified with the industrial applications. Also, better stiffness of the coil can be analyzed with this. So we are going for the application of tribology of the materials. Next slide, please. Yeah, now it's an important tool, tribology or nanotribology. So we have discussed about the synthesis, structural elucidation, as well as spectral properties. Just an special application, I'm just discussing this, tribology or nanotribology. When you're using nanoscale, it's nanotribology. When you are using bulk case, it is said to be simply a tribology. Next slide, please. The same structure for the different material is said to be mentioned here. Radius, distance, diameter, and a small edge representation, yes, like that. So next slide, please. So tribological case, it's said to be not yet published. We have sent the paper for publication, the TFM PHB crystal. It's said to be under the scrutiny for evaluation to get published. What we are analyzing in the tribology is, whenever you are using any material, the wear and tear, the surface changing effect is said to be identified for the macro and nano. That what you are doing is, either the material can be used for this application, or any material like a wooden piece or some iron piece is said to be taken, that is coated with our films or coated with our material, macro scale and nano scale, from which we are identifying the influx parameters for the electronic applications and tribological parameter for the mechanical applications. The sample is said to be identified with 0.1 millimeter diameter and average diameter of 0.1 mm, which is distinct coil shear, you know, shear stress like that. So it is 0.91 GPa said to be obtained. And for shear stress value of 0.2546, for the stiffness value of 1.37 is said to be identified with this. The nanotribology of the sample is said to be given in the next slide. Slide number 66, please. Yeah, here 0.12 millimeter is considered. So the film corresponds to the filter effectiveness of 3.6127. The variation is observed. So macro scale and nano scale, the change is said to be obtained. So nano coating is said to be preferred for the tribological, as well as influx is said to be identified. Next slide, please. So when you are having good influx, electronic gadgets, what we are using, the tools are nothing but electronic gadgets, and in mechanoelastic productions, because suddenly when we are throwing something, there will have some mechanical effect, then only the surface will be adapted to the material what is to be thrown like that. So the mechanoelastic productions, and for Verva coils, that is important. The springs for improved solidness, improved effectiveness of the stiffness is said to be identified with the tribological and influx parameters. So based on the tribology only, the paper is said to be easily accepted based on the characterization. Next slide, please. This is the data for that long wave, short wave, and the influx parameter for macro and nano scaling. Next slide, please. These are the data for this BGLBM. This is also you are sent for one Scopus Index journal with one of our MPhil scholars, and we are sent for this publication. This BGLBM, bisglycine lithium bromide monohydrate, this crystal influx and tribological parameters also studied for this, and where you are given the data. So we are sent for this publication. Soon it will be accepted, I think. Next slide, please. So here also for nanoscale, it is 2.4325 microns or micrometer size is said to be obtained for this BGLBM macro and nanoscale. So it's important filter application is said to be identified. Next slide, please. So for the same BGLBM, we have the crystal data. We have the powder XRD indexed pattern. Next slide, please. So what you have converted is said to be the macro crystal is converted into nano, and the crystal size with the time in hours is identified. So when the time is more, the crystal size is reduced. So for perfect nanometer size, we have to wait for around 2 days. So it's 40 hours, more than 40 hours means for 24 plus 24, 48 hours. So it is nearly more than 1.5 days. Like that, we have to wait. Next slide, please. So this is the fluorescence effect for macro crystal. It is 403 nanometer. Next slide, please. Fluorescence effect for nano crystal of the BGLBM is 397. So 403, 397, some around 6 or 7 nanometers only varied. So this is a perfect crystal we can identify, because macro and nano size, when you are breaking, there should not be much change. But now, due to nanometer effect, there will be a slight change that is said to be observed here. So long range of more than 100 or 120 nanometers said to be changed, then there will be a deficiency in the macro or nano scale. Like that we can observe. There will be no prolonged increase, a short duration increase. So it is a perfect crystal according to the macro and nano scaling of the fluorescence we can identify. The band gap engineering data, some of them they are utilizing for some other purposes, that is said to be used here. So this particular crystal will have the band gap engineering applications. Next slide, please. Yeah, fourth crystal, it's said to be unpublished. Next slide, please. So just up to which what I have discussed is synthesis part using solution growth method, structural representation using the single and powder XRD method, and we are having some spectral applications, and the three papers we have published in elsewhere, and Springer is to be analyzed, including the spectral data. Tribology is separately analyzed. Now this crystal is to be sent for publications. It is an AMHTYB crystal. It's simply we can call it as benzonitrile crystal, because the effect of acetyl methyl is to be general case. Benzonitrile is to be present. Benzonitrile will have more impact for hardness. That you can get it through, and benzonitrile, benzo means it will have some effect, so benzopyran like that, so it has some biological effect like anti-inflammatory and antioxidant property. It could be identified based on the name and chemical composition and structure. Like that I am telling. Next slide, please. This is the ball effect of the molecular structure of the particular AMHTYB crystal. So the structure is resolved using the software. Software is running for some hours to identify the crystalline data and the structural data of the crystal to the diffraction pattern. Next slide, please. Yeah, we are representing previously this monoclinic nature, monoclinic crystal system, and some orthorhombic crystal system like that. We have the full crystal structure. For the full crystal structure, as a crystal grower, the faculties and the students, they might know very well the unit cell parameters. based on the lattice parameters, we are confined in the crystal structure. The lattice parameter is the minimal tool. That lattice parameter is analyzed using this particular software, like A, B, C, like that. Because what we are drawing is according to the lattices of the Bravais, that this is said to be the triclinic or monoclinic system, like that. But structurally, we are resolving the same. It is said to be identified the unit cell parameters of this particular crystal using computational method, that is softwares. Next slide, please. So van der Waal effect is said to be more because when crystal is grown, one side is plus, one side is minus. So like that, we are identifying the same. But it's not equally shared, but it will have final effect of neutrality. So the van der Waal impact will be there because it is a weak interaction at one side. That weak interaction is said to be taken consider, and it's said to be applied for the crystal, and we have the projection of the atoms using this weak interaction using the software, and we are identifying the same based on the 15% impact, 50%, 15, 50, and 100% impact, like that. So it is more than 75%. Either this should be a 75% or 100% impact of the van der Waal effect for the software, using the software for the particular crystal. Next slide, please. This is a molecular potential for this AMHTYB crystal. It's said to be identified. Red zones and blue zones represents the variation in the electron rich and poor status, like that. That is said to be confined with Gaussian contour also. This is analyzed with a different representation. They are calling it as molecular electrostatic potential. We are calling it as molecular potential only, small variations. Next slide, please. Yeah, molecular system of the surface of AMHTYB. So the surface is analyzed, how the impact is. We can call it as mapping. And mathematically, we are calling it as mapping of the materials and grouping of the material, like that. That will be done by using this software. Next slide, please. Solvent surface. Generally, we are using water, acetone, ethanol, methanol as the main solvents. If suppose the material is said to be very hard and it is having different percentage of different elements and different combination of different representation of atoms, like that, then we have to go for some special solvents. General case, we are identifying the general utility as a water representation, water molecule representation of the solvent. It's taken care by the software to get this. So solvent surface structural impact of AMHTYB crystal is mentioned here. Next slide, please. Unit cell is the small pattern, and three-dimensional representation of the crystal of the AMHTYB is over there in the slide 83. It is a three-dimensional impact with the unit cell counter representation of this box is to be mentioned over there. We have some halos effect, some rotational effects are there that I have not mentioned, that is said to be not studied here. We have the impact of the theoretical calculation, and it's said to be not yet published. So just I have shown the result what we have done for the purpose of getting the idea or knowledge. Next slide, please. So I am representing the overall conclusion. Actually, a paper means each conclusion is to be there for each crystal. I have given overall conclusion. Good quality NLO crystal and nano crystals are grown. NLO crystals synthesized by solution growth method, nano crystals by ball milling method. Nano scale is by ball milling, and spectral and optical confirmation is there. Spectral confirmation using spectral techniques, optical confirmation by NLO property and UV, right? That it's said to be the spectral application and optical confirmation. And the diffraction pattern represents the crystal is said to be grown or not. Electronic properties, fluorescence and filters. Even though fluorescence is spectroscopic property, I have mentioned this electronic property because it represents the peaks in which the material is having any flaw that could be identified. So the sharpness can be identified, and it's also change in nanometer, it will give the proper case. The transmitter percentage, that is the effect of optical properties, also can be identified using UV and this fluorescence. So I am putting the electronic applications can be identified using fluorescence, filter and influx. Filter is, so many filters are there according to electronics. We are using optoelectronic filters. So that should be taken care. Next, industrial utility by tribology. I have not mentioned the biological property because I have not represented or mentioned the biological property in this particular webinar. But we have published for the CPD crystal, the second crystal. For that, we have published the anti-diabetic and anti-inflammatory property. That is also taken care. A simple logic is, so many of them, research scholars and all, they are asking how we can identify the biological applications. When the crystal structure is said to be straight, it will have some applications in marketing products like cosmetics and all. When it's having some special branches, according to the chemistry people, they might know very well the bonding and all. So according to the structure, special bonding is there, that will have special application like anti-cancer, anti-diabetic, like that. Any branching. So that we have to identify whether it is said to be present or not, how it could be impacted over there like that. Then we can confine the biological implication of the crystal in the biological or pharmaceutical application like that. That we have done some around 10 papers for anti-diabetic and anti-inflammatory property like that. Next slide, please. Yeah, some of the list of publication in our college in R&D. As an R&D in charge, I have to go for good publications, and I have to show the same for the work it's said to be rendered and how it's said to be taken care. Next slide, please. So we have some 200 plus UGC and 100 plus UGC care publications, 50 plus Scopus SCAE, that is elsewhere Springer publications, and 325 plus conference publications. It's said to be confined with that our R&D. Next slide, please. So some of the publications I'm showing here, this is the anti-inflammatory property of the CPD crystal. It's said to be published in elsewhere. It's one of the scholars from Government College. He has grown the crystal, Mr. Kolanjinathan. Next slide, please. This is published in Scopus AAP proceedings. So it's a computational analysis of LPNPT crystals for Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's is said to be forgetting things. The aged people, they cannot recollect what is said to be happened on 2 days back like that. So the treatment of the same could be with this sample is said to be theoretically confined, and it's said to be presented for the Scopus channel. Next slide, please. It is also one of the theoretical calculations of this DMN crystal for fluorescence and this gap, energy band gap analysis. Next slide, please. It's said to be anti-diabetic property of the fumarate crystals. Next slide, please. ACDC conductivity study of the fumarate is said to be identified. Next slide, please. A DMN crystal, NLO and computational and other applications to be identified. Next slide, please. Anti-diabetic property published in elsewhere for that alendronium malate. L-alanine, L-arginine will have some impact over some biological applications. Next slide, please. Anti-diabetic application of picrates, valinium picrate. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a nano particles, ZNO nanoparticles from that neem leaves, published in the Journal of Material Science for this solar cell fabrication. It's said to be having good impact using domestic microwave oven. It's recently published in 2020. Next slide, please. This is said to be one of the journals that we are having the glycinium malate influx value. Next slide, please. It's other representation of LEHCM. Next slide, please. This is one of the important material, CPD, for which we are having dielectric fluorescence and filter influx, published in Electronics Journal. Next slide, please. This is the optic journal. The first crystal DPPA is said to be grown properly and is said to be published. The scholar is said to be Dr. Mr. Satish Kumar, and we have the confined work for this optic elsewhere journal. Next slide, please. I wish you all the best for everyone. Next slide, please. Thank you all for your patient hearing. Next slide, please. Any queries? It could be asked.
I request the participants to clarify their queries with our resource person now. Participants have any queries? Once again, I request the participants to clarify their doubts, their queries with our resource person.
Yeah, one of them, they mentioned in the chat that what is the range of hard and soft crystals in the micro hardness tester. When you are directly go with that software, the structural representation is there. They are having 1.6 as the value. Above and below, we can classify the hardness and softness like that. But when you are going according to 1H, the value is to be 2 like that. So which methodology you are adopting, from which you can get the final hardness of the specimen can be classified. And some of them, they are asked for feedback link, that the coordinators, they will give that feedback link. Covered good amount of information quickly like that, they have mentioned. Thank you. And this is the question is to be according to the chat. Any other questions? If it's there, I will answer. Now, someone asked, how can you prepare crystals through ball milling? Say, we are not preparing crystals through ball milling. We have already macro crystals. The laboratory prepared crystals, what we are having is there. We are finally grinding the same. The ball milling is nothing but milling the material. Milling means some grinding. It's like a grinder. So, the macro crystal is finely powdered using that. When the crystal is finely powder, that is said to be a nanoscaled crystal, micro or nanoscaled crystal. So I need nanometer range. How I can change the nano macro scale to nanoscale? Directly I can't do, manually I can't do. So I need some milling and other methods from which I am getting the nano crystals. So this is the direct representation of this macro crystal to nano form by milling. So we can't grow by milling. We can just break the hard materials or bulk materials to small pieces like that. So it is in nanometer change, we are calling it as nanocrystals. And when we are grinding, it is said to be nanoscale only, that we are confirmed using this particle size analyzer, same term like that. So we are getting the same, the nanometer scale is identified. Yeah, someone is asked the TGDD, what is the major purpose? Say the stability of the material in our heat element, heating nature of the element present, or the melting point confirmation of the elements, or water content removal of the element can be analyzed using the heating effect, TGADTA. Yeah, some of the cases it will be there. Terahertz, you are asking. Some of the cases, some of the materials will have these applications, but not all the material. Depends upon the composition, it may vary. Nanocrystal, which method is suitable, how to confirm the nano size? So when you are having the nano size, this nano particle size analyzer is the best tool to get the nano scale. And also you can go for SEM and TEM to get the nanometer analysis like that. What we are doing is, we have the bulk crystal. Some 10 hours, 20 hours, we will have the different nanometer scale. We are getting it, sending for analysis. So we are confirming that after 10 hours it is said to be this nanometer, like that we are confirming. So after 40 hours we are having the final 30 nanometer, like that size. One crystal only 16 nanometer what we have grown, like that. So this nanometer scale, based on that we'll go for good applications. Which material is suitable for nanocrystal? So milling only suitable. We cannot directly grow the nanocrystal, I think so, according to my knowledge is concerned. PKs maybe need to maintain grow crystal, yes, properly, because your solution will have different pH representation. Generally we are going for water or distilled water or double distilled water for some of the crystals. pH is said to be the concentration. So hydrogen and concentration is nothing but pH according to chemistry. So that should be maintained properly. So same material, same lab and same liquid solvent should be used properly to get the proper identification of the solution to get through the magnetic stirrer and are properly stirred. When you are varying the pH, you will not get the proper crystals. Amine and aldehyde add to condensation, we add acetic acid, please say about that. Nothing, I want to get removed that. That's what it's said to be condensed in the process itself. We are not manually doing anything, right? We are not manually doing anything. So it's said to be properly removed from that to identify the removal of nature, and it's said to be confirmed using the spectral data. So it is not present. FTIR, I think, so it's not present there. What about the quantum confinement nature in nanocrystal and micro-macrocrystal, sir? Will that change due to grinding milling? Yeah, definitely that is said to be changed. That's what, say, material is same. This, what we can say, the nanoparticle will have more impact in biological and other applications. So that is said to be confirmed with that. Structural change will not be there. Structural change will not be taken place. It will be same. Whenever you are calling it as nanocrystal, it will be same only. Size is said to be reduced. Okay, so don't get confused with the structure. Property may vary. It's like a small bicycle and a higher level bicycle, that's it. So destination is same, process is same. Only the speed and the level of size matters. Same is said to be considered here. Final representation is same structure, but size is different. So that is the quantum confinement. Okay. What are the most prominent application of these nanocrystals? Yeah, what I told is it can go for band gap engineering application, optoelectronic application, tribological application, like that. What we have done is we have also done the macro and nanocrystals said to be confined for anti-diabetic. Macro crystal I was sent when the crystal is said to be grown. After converted to nano, that also I was sent for biological applications. So change is said to be observed over there. That they are using enzymes. Biological people, they are using enzymes. So enzymes and all, they will have more impact for nano. So there will be a drastic change in some of the properties and less change in other properties in biological applications for nanocrystals. Right? Okay. Any other questions? The terahertz applications you are asking, it depends upon the crystal. The optoelectric nature should be more. And frequency it should withstand. Tera means it to be more than this giga. Now what we are using is in giga range only, 10 to the power 9 only. And hardness also we are using giga pascal only. So tera, we have to identify the whether the crystal is can be withstand for higher frequency. If it's not there, we can go for some shockwave applications. The variations should be considered like that. Crystal grow, we concentrate of acidic and basic compounds. Yeah, of course, that is said to be neutrality. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for your comments. Yeah, acid and base is said to be there, na? That is said to, from there we only we can identify which is said to be suitable for which applications, like that. Generally, crystal or nanoparticle, we need chemistry applications, chemistry knowledge predominantly. Then I can go for physical applications like optics, spectroscopy, like that. Then suppose you want to show your work in a brighter manner for good publications, then we have to go for some biological, anti-diabetic, antibacterial, like that. It's a normal small things, anti-cancer, anti-tumor, like that. That we have to go for concentrated output of the crystal, like that. So from which we can consider that it could be applied for this crystal like that. Generally, any crystal can be grown and any crystal can be represented for biology application. We can't represent that. We have to identify benzopyran anti-cancer applications like that. Some other application. So we are having previously we have one crystal that the composition will have definitely antioxidant and anti-inflammatory property, and for some pain relieving like that, because the combination of the chemical is said to be identified already reported. So it is called Kaumarin group. So like that crystal is said to be, I have given one talk in SSN that the Kaumarin group is present in the crystal, so it is having some antipyretic and pain reliever like that. So that applications we have gone through. So you have to identify the crystal combination, crystal structure, crystal methodology, size of the crystal in macro and nano scale, and we have to go for biological applications. For optical and spectral applications, we have to confine with the size as well as the crystal procedure, what monoclinic or which type of system, and what is the chemical present over there, then we can go for the applications. Size, impact, applications, structure also taken care for the biological applications. Otherwise, we won't get the proper result in biology and pharma applications like that. Yeah, any other queries? Yeah, thank you one and all for your nice comments. What are the things up to my knowledge I am sharing with you? You have any queries you can ask. Otherwise, I will just wind up the session. Yeah, Mr. Chandrasaran mentioned excellent session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful attainment in the field of physics.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to welcome Mrs. S. Shanta Sheila, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, to propose a vote of thanks. Please, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's give me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for this webinar. I would like to thank our chief guest for his inspirational thoughts. I would like to thank our principal, vice principal, dean of academics, and all our staff members. Last but not least, I thank the participants for making this webinar in a grand success. Once again, I thank you all. Thank you.